thanks for being here this afternoon. My name is Kevin Pounds. I'm executive director of ANEW Place. And this is an exciting day for us. As many of you know, Friday just after noon, we closed on this property, the Champlain Inn. And I think it's safe to say, not just for us, but for many people in the Chittenden Homeless Alliance, for the city of Burlington, and I think I could probably say I'm speaking for the mayor's office and the city councilors too, is that having a year-round low-barrier facility has been a priority. And so, not just for ANEW Place, but for a lot of people that are standing around here, this is a big deal today. I have notes here. I've been known for going off my notes a little bit. I'll try to stick with them so we stick with time. But I think it's safe to say that for all of us, COVID-19 has impacted us. And that whether it's like us or a family member getting sick or the economics of it, we felt that in some way. I think it's also fair to say that there's certain groups in our community that have been hit especially hard. And that especially includes the people in our neighbors who are without homes. And one thing I love about Burlington is that there is an ethos here of what happens to one of us impacts all of us. We may not always live that out perfectly, but I really do believe this to be true of my neighbors. I'm a Burlington resident myself, is that when something happens to one person in our community, the rest of the community feels that too, and tries to figure out, hey, what can we do about that issue? And the reason I think this is really important is having this year-round low barrier facility here is that it's a very practical way of saying to some of our most vulnerable neighbors in a very practical way that you matter to us. The thought that goes through my head a lot, and I'm not an extremely nostalgic person, but I do care about history. And one of the reasons I came to work at ANEW Place several years ago was because of the history. In 1982, there was a small group of people from local congregations that saw the growing numbers of their neighbors that were becoming homeless. And they had this core belief that God cared about these people, and if God cared about them, that they should care about them and do something about it. And the thing that stood out to me about this group of people, and I've met some of them over the years, is they weren't social work professionals. They were just people who cared. And so they started a nonprofit, they raised money, they bought what had historically been the liquor store on North Street and reimagined it as a sober shelter. And so almost every week that at some point during the week, like I play through that in my head, and what it reminds me of is when we're looking at our most vulnerable neighbors, when we look at our neighbors that are experiencing homelessness, if we're gonna help them, it's gonna require taking risks. And it's going to require making sacrifices. And so there's a lot of people around here today who have taken risks and made sacrifices to make that possible. And so I wanted to just take a second and just thank some people that have been a part of that team today, because this doesn't happen without a team of people. I get to be the talking head for what a lot of other people do to make things happen. One thing, Michael Riley, he's not here. He's the owner of Champlain Inn Associates, who sold us this. And when I approached him a couple of months ago, he didn't know me from anyone. And I told him what we were thinking about doing and said, hey, would you be even willing to have a conversation with me and one of our board members, David McKay? And he did. And within a couple of weeks, we were working on a purchase and sell agreement. That just doesn't happen, right? Unless somebody has a heart for what we want to do here. I want to say a big, big thank you to the Vermont Housing and Conservation Board. Their director, Gus, is here. He's going to be speaking in just a minute, for believing in this project and providing much-needed federal coronavirus relief funds. I mean, doing a project like this requires serious money, and I can't say thank you enough to them for believing in the project and what its mission is. I want to say a big thank you to Cindy Reid from Cathedral Square. She's somewhere nearby, right there. Cindy's been doing a lot of the heavy lifting on this project. She's Director of Development for Cathedral Square. All this construction, she helped us come up with the game plan, right? And so she's doing a lot of things behind the scenes, but I would be going nuts if she wasn't there on the other end of phone calls and emails constantly. Mark Sammet with Wright & Morrissey, I mean, you're going to see their stuff around here. They do a lot of stuff in the city, and they're doing all kinds of things seen and unseen to get this project up and running by December 1st. Bob Duncan with Duncan Wisniewski Architecture. I want to thank our attorney, Hobart Popick, who's not here, with Langrock, Sperry, and Wool. And I want to say like a big thank you. One thing we appreciate a lot is our partnership with the City of Burlington. A year ago when we agreed to take this on, I remember one of the city councilors came to meet with us, the mayor's office came to meet with us and said this was a priority, and none of us knew that COVID-19 was going to hit. The mayor didn't know I was going to ask him to do a sit-in at North Beach Campground so we could open up RVs, and I told him that we weren't going to require him to come here so we could get this open in time, but we're thankful that it is opening on time. But across, just over this last year, the city has been incredibly supportive since day one. And that goes from the city council. A couple weeks ago, the city council unanimously passed an emergency resolution. On a personal level, I feel that too. I mean, Joan, Shannon spearheaded like making sure that city council came forward. I'm gonna do a shout out too to my two city councilors, because they're my friends in addition to my city councilor. So I'm really thankful to Franklin Polino and my good friend, Ollie Jank, for just being good friends and listening to me vent when I'm trying to figure things out. And I thank you for the mayor for being here. He's gonna be speaking to this because I know this has been a long-term passion project of his to see this happen. And I also wanna say thank you to one person that is never in the spotlight with the city. And she's gonna hate me for saying this. Her name is Grace Sifo. And she's assistant director for CEDO. She's one of those people that like will never be behind a microphone, but does all kinds of things to make sure projects happen, right? And helps to figure out how to make them happen. So thank you, Grace. Thank you. Most of all, I want to thank a handful of people here that I get to be the talking head for a lot, and that's ANEW Place's frontline staff. I couldn't ask all of them to be here today because they're working, but I did ask five of them to be here, and they've worked tirelessly to provide a supportive shelter environment and a basement in RVs and tents, all while navigating the challenges of COVID. And right now they're revving up to get this place open by December 1st. So I actually invited five to be here this afternoon. Heather Bush, our shelter coordinator. David, Lanny, Nick, and Ben. And one reason I wanted to ask them to be here is, you can applaud them. I was sharing this with my wife and children around the dinner table the other day. When I used to do that, then I know it's true, right? There's something about it that makes it true. That if I or them were ever to hit rock bottom and be in need, those five people over there are exactly who I would want them to encounter, right? And so I just want to ask this for the reporters here. If you want to interview somebody when this is over, don't interview me. Interview one of them, right? And they can tell you what makes ANEW Place tick, why we serve the people we serve. As we all know, we're only good as the team around us. So I just want to thank the people that are going to be speaking up here. I want to thank you five back there. I want to thank our board members that are here today too. There's several new board members that are around the crowd. Thank you for playing a part in making this a reality. And we're looking forward to being able to open this December 1st and serve 50 of our neighbors who have been experiencing homelessness. So thank you.
Hello. Good afternoon, everybody. Kevin, thank you for your leadership throughout this journey that really did begin about a year ago with ANEW Place taking over for, I think it was at the time, the fifth year of operations of the low barrier shelter down on Wisniewski Avenue. And none of us knew what the next 12 months had in store with this facility. Your resilience and your team's resilience throughout this has has been remarkable, and we definitely wouldn't be standing here today without the passion that you have for this work and the energy your whole team has brought to this. I remember Kevin's joke about this sit-in. He's talking about the day that we opened the, after having under an emergency basis closed that facility on Winooski Avenue. It wasn't really clear where the 20 people who were living in that facility would go. In a remarkably quick period of time, a new place, the state, DCF, and the city worked together and hatched this idea of leasing RVs and so that each individual could have their own RV and not be in this crowded facility on Winooski Avenue anymore. And the plan was coming together so quickly that we got to North Beach and the agreement hadn't been completed yet. And night was falling and it wasn't quite clear if the agreement would get done in time for people to move in that night. And they did, and I do remember it was one of the important hopeful moments in those early scary days of this pandemic, I think, that sort of captured the sense that we're all in this together as a community, and that no one was going to get left behind, and that we're going to find a way to protect everyone, no matter what their situation was. And it was a day that felt different than felt like, you know, we had sort of broken business as usual, and that we were able to get things done that we wouldn't be able to get done in normal times. And I definitely remember hoping that would lead to today, that would lead to us being able to finally break through this many year running challenge of having a year round low barrier facility. I wasn't sure we would, because it had been a long and challenging road. And I do just want to quickly recap the history of what brought us today. It's not that long ago that there was not a consensus that low barrier facilities made sense at all, even in the winter. And up until 2014, we had people die frequently during the winter. I think just about every winter there used to be an exposure death with someone who was stuck outside, they didn't have a place to go. Despite that, there has been a many year running debate about whether there should be some kind of low barrier option in the winter. Finally, in 2014, the CVOEO, with the support of the city, with the support of my administration, we decided we'd have a pilot. We were able to use the Ethan Allen facility, the club there that was had just been decommissioned as a club, and that was where we had this first sort of experiment. And it was clear immediately that this was a much needed facility. It was clear immediately that it didn't create the kind of problems that many people were concerned would be created by a low barrier facility. So by the next spring of 2015, I actually put in my state of the city that March that we needed to find a way to continue to have this winter facility. And we have every winter since. There has been a low barrier facility first run, again, by CBOEO, then it was taken on by COTS, then it was the Community Health Centers of Burlington ran it very well for 3 years, and then this last year, a new place took it over. By 2017, it was clear to me and some others that this really needed to become a year-round facility, that the lack of a year-round low-barrier facility was a disservice to people living in homelessness, they're chronically homeless. And it was something that the lack of the facility created challenges for the community. And so in the state of the city that year, 2017, I said, let's find a way to make this a year-round facility. The facility that opened in 2017 did stay in commission longer. It lasted, instead of closing in April, it lasted until June, in part because the city started budgeting local dollars, which generally way kind of responsibilities are divided in this state. The state pays for social services, municipalities don't. We made an exception to that with this low barrier facility. We started putting local dollars in, and Every year since, the city council has supported that, and we have continued to have local dollars. But still, we couldn't break through and find a way that the expense turned out to be much more than had been hoped for. We couldn't find a way to actually turn it into a year-round facility until 2020 and until this opportunity created itself with the COVID and with these additional federal dollars available for a facility like this. So, you know, I just wanna, why was this so hard? And I've come to think the reason it's so hard is the need for a facility like this in some ways clashes with our sense of who we are as Vermont and who we want to be. We believe we're a small, compassionate place that, you know, that doesn't have a chronic homelessness issue. And that is an ideal that I very much believe in and this administration believes in, and we've worked towards that ideal to realize that ideal on many fronts. We repurposed some of the federal dollars that we get as a community towards a housing first model that prioritizes chronically homeless individuals. We have worked on many fronts to create as much housing as we can over the last 8 years because we know that the lack of a supply of housing is one of the drivers of homelessness. It's not the only driver of homelessness, though. There are many other issues, and one of them being opioid use, which has been one of the reasons we've hit that issue so hard. I agree that this Vermont should aspire and work towards being a place that does not have a chronic homelessness issue. And we have made, by some measure, some progress towards that. And yet, chronic homelessness does exist here in Vermont. It does exist here in Chittenden County and in Burlington. And today's event is a big step towards recognizing that and facing our challenges head on. And I'm so thankful to a whole number of people for getting us to this important day. And I am going to just take the liberty to thank a few of them directly. And I want to say thank you to Kevin and his team. ANEW Place, almost alone, when the city went to the Homelessness Alliance in 2017 and said, we got to find a way to make this a year-round facility. ANEW Place heard that call and has stepped up, and I'm so appreciative for the partnership. I want to thank the city team, in addition to Grace, who did a great job with this. The whole CETO team was involved. Luke and Will also worked on this project hard. The city attorney's office had to grapple with a number of last-minute sort of emergency issues and work through that. Our permitting inspections office was a part of making this happen. And I'm not sure if there's anyone here today from Parks, Recreation, and Waterfront. That team, really back on that March day when the North Beach campground was repurposed, worked extremely hard to re-envision that campground for that use and make it happen. I see we got a number of city councilors here today. It's awesome to be joined by Councilor Jang and Councilor Carpenter, and Councilor Shannon is here, is going to say a couple words in a moment. The council had to pass an emergency regulation a few weeks ago, as well as continuously budget funds towards this low barrier facility in some challenging budget times. Very thankful for the partnership of the council. And in particular, I want to thank the South End councilors and the neighbors immediately around here who, and maybe some of whom are with us today, I'm not sure. Often projects like this die because the neighbors are, these are often, you know, not popular facilities. I am so thankful that the community here and the councilors in the South End understood that this was a critical community need, understood that some of the fears about this facility would not be realized, that this is going to be a professionally managed, excellent facility, and made sure that we're moving forward with these plans. And I want to thank Cindy Reid and Cathedral Square for the critical role that they stepped into in a real time crunch, bringing their experience and their capacity to bear here. And I want to say a huge thanks to Gus Seelig and the whole team at VHCB. you know, Gus is really, I think many of us think of Gus as sort of a Vermont treasure. He's one of the things that makes this state such an exceptional place, and he is a rare combination of idealist and pragmatist. And when this effort came very close to dying, after another South End concept did not get over the finish line, Gus gave outstanding advice and wisdom, really, on how to, in a very short period of time, come back with another concept and get us to Dan. And, you know, this is the thing I've worked on most directly and most with Gus, and I'm so thankful for the partnership, Gus, and what you did to get us to today. So, thank you, everyone else. I'm sure I've left some people off, but what a great day. Thank you.
So I'm Gus Seelig. I'm the director for the Vermont Housing and Conservation Board. Mr. Mayor, Kevin, thank you for your kind words. And what a great day to be together. And thanks for the hockey stick. That's wonderful.
That's a unique tool.
You know, this feels like a very, to me, very dystopian time. We're all in masks. And this dystopian time has challenged us to understand who really are essential workers, what the ravages of economic inequality and racial inequality really mean, why housing has to be seen as part of healthcare. We're here today for lots of reasons, and early on, Erhard Manka and the Affordable Housing Coalition, the Champlain Housing Trust, and our friends at Evernorth said to the state of Vermont, everything you want to do on housing is really important, but if you don't add to the supply, use some of the more than $1 billion that Pat Leahy got for every small state in the country. If you don't use some of that money to add to the supply, there's going to be a big miss. And then your legislative leaders, including Senator Sorotkin, Senator Ash, Senator Kitchell, Tom Stevens, Mitzi Johnson, all said, yeah, that's really important, we're going to get it done. And what that meant was that we could make a grant of $2.5 million for the purchase and rehabilitation of this facility. This happened because of a new place and the city's tenacity and its heart. It happened because when the first project couldn't quite get there, Michael Monte told me that he thought that this property could be bought. And Kevin and the board followed up on it and made it happen. And it also happened because Kim Fitzgerald, when I called, said, yeah, I will turn Cindy Reid loose to support a move and get an incredible amount of work done, both to get a deal signed and to get the rehab done by the CRF deadline in December. So thank you so much, Cindy. I'm going to be very, very brief. I want to thank Jen Holler, our policy director, who worked with all those legislators, our housing staff who are not here, Martin Hahn and Ariane Kassam, who worked on this project. As I was driving up today, there's too much bad news, and I turned the news off and turned on some music. And a friend of mine played in the bluegrass band, the Bluegrass Gospel Project, and they have a song called Heaven. And it's a meditation about whether there's heaven on earth or not. And there's a line in it that asks, will there be hope for the hopeless? Will there be homes for the hopeless? For the homes for the homeless. And today, all of you, the city, ANEW, council members, have all said with your hearts, yes, there's going to be hope, yes, there are going to be homes. Thank you so much.
Hi, I'm Cindy Reid from Cathedral Square, and I want to thank...
Shout, Cindy.
Sorry, what?
Shout.
I can develop, but I have a hard time speaking loud. So thanks. Thank you all for being here today. Thank you so much, Kevin, and ANEW, and all the staff at ANEW, and board members, and the city's great leadership and VHCV's funding of this incredible project. As Gus highlighted, the inequities that we're dealing with, we have an absolute housing crisis in our state. Affordability is a major problem. Cathedral Square is working on developing permanent housing. And in the meantime, we need a first stop. And ANEW is wonderful at providing the first step for folks to get housing security. And we love thinking that and knowing that 50 people will be here soon and have a warm bed to sleep in and walls and a roof to keep them safe and services and caring staff to help them develop their next steps and how they can lead their lives with dignity. So the thing that Cathedral Square and ANEW, one of the reasons why we play well together is we very compassionately believe and treat human beings with dignity, and that regardless of your resources, everyone is a human being, which is what this place is about. So congratulations to get this far, and we look forward to getting a massive amount of improvements in a really short period of time and opening the doors on December 1st. Thank you.
Thank you, Cindy, and thank you to everybody who's spoken before me, because these are all the people in our community that are really getting things done. And I think what we're seeing here today is our village, because it does take a village to take care of everybody in that village. I first encountered ANEW Place. I appreciated your history, Kevin, because I first encountered ANEW Place when I was ANEW city councilor, and I was introduced to it by Republican Representative George Chabot invited us for a tour, and it was myself, Progressive City Councilor Phil Fiermonte, and George Chabot, and that's where I learned about their values for wraparound services and lifting people up. Their methods work. They take care of people. And I also really appreciate the work of the mayor and the administration. It's really important to remember that all of our good intentions isn't what gets things done. It's people willing to step up with creative solutions and find the money to do it. And that's what this administration has done that nobody else could do, or at least nobody else has done. As the mayor said, this is not the model in this state. The city of Burlington is stepping up because we believe that housing is a human right. And I also want to speak to really the human side of this, because mostly we're talking about all the people that have come together to make it happen, which is, you know, thank goodness that they have. And it's only been with real intelligence and persistence. And I will also tell you that Vermont Housing Conservation Board is an amazing group of people. They challenge ideas. They come from different perspectives. They don't just say yes. And were it not for a little resistance from them, we would not be here today. But it was that challenge combined with a commitment to still getting to the goal, and the help of Gus to get there, and Michael and Kevin to locate the site, to negotiate the deal. But ultimately, we're here because housing is a human right, because we believe in that as a community. And I want to thank the neighbors here that have approached this project in that way. And a couple of those neighbors, actually the closest abutters to this project, are here today to support the project. And I want to thank Val Carzello and Will Mormondo. And Will, as being part of the village, Will has taken my whiny dog for a walk. But really thank everybody who has come together, because this is a place where people will feel the community's love, where they can get well, where they can get rest, where they can lay their heads down when they have a migraine headache and they can't function anymore. This is a place to call home for now and lift people up. And so thank you so much to everyone here who's made this possible. And the South End welcomes ANEW Place to the Champlain Inn. Thank you.
That is, I think that's this prepared program. I think the members of the media had questions. Kevin and I, others, be happy to try to answer them. Courtney.
Question, I think you said it was a $2.5 million grant. Does that cover the entire cost of purchasing the property?
Kevin, maybe your guess. It
covers the entire cost of the purchase. ANEW is raising money in addition to the grants to help with the rehab. Some of the money is to also go for the rehab that can be done by the CRF deadline. Kevin, I don't know if you want to speak to how much additionally you're raising.
Yeah, I mean, there's the cost of actually getting this up and running, which is, you know, the purchase of the building and the
have, and so the CRF funds, Coronavirus Relief funds, cover the majority of that. As far as like annual operations, I mean, that comes from a mix of like, you know, state funding through a HOP grant. The city supports us, you know, with annual money too. And then we private fundraise a lot too. I mean, you know, historically until probably a year ago, realistically, ANEW Place was 100% privately funded. So we've got a pretty, all I can say is we're really, really thankful for community support, because that's why we're still around since 1982, because it's mainly our neighbors in Champlain County that really support our operations making this happen.
Sorry, the renovations, you still have to fundraise for the renovations?
Well, the CRF funds are covering the large chunk of the renovations.
Yeah. How much money have left to raise?
Actually, I don't know off the top of my head. So.
Are you concerned at all about financial sustainability going forward? I mean, the world is a little bit precarious right now with the pandemic still. I mean, this is a larger sort of operation.
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, I think that this goes back to something I said earlier. I think that if you're going to help people that are most vulnerable in your community, it's going to require taking risks and making sacrifices, or you're just never going to do it. You're just going to have excuses.
What's the portion, about how much money is the city contributing to the project right now? And the ongoing, it sounded like it was a continued, like, part of the budget going forward.
Yeah, so we've had an appropriation in our budget for since I think the fiscal year 2018 budget was the first that we had. We budgeted $60,000 a year every year since then. That was enough to expand the months of operation beyond what the state paid for. So during cold weather months, there is a structural funding source for this kind of service, because there may be others that know the history better than me, but basically the state takes the responsibility for ensuring people, there's a emergency low temperature hotel program, and the state has actually found it more efficient to fund during the winter months this facility than to put additional hotel vouchers for that. The UVM Medical Center has also been a financial contributor during winter months. The challenge always has been, since we've been trying to make this a year-round facility, is the additional expense involved in becoming a year-round operation. The city has been budgeting, again, $60,000 a year. We're definitely committed. I'm committed. At least budgets that I'm responsible will have at least that amount going forward. I think it may well be, as this budget is finalized, there may be a need for a modest increase on that in future budget years. And I'm open to that, and I'm open to taking that to the council. We are expanding. The voters last spring expanded the housing trust fund, almost doubled it, and this is an expense that would be that gives us some additional capacity for making investments like this going forward. Actually, the state legislature just approved that in the last month or so. So, in future budget years, that'll be an additional source. So, I also think I know there are other municipalities that supported this. The city of South Burlington and Colchester. Also saw the need for a facility like this. This may be something that we can get some partnership for others in the future. The VHCB didn't approve this until they had assurances that there would be, not all the details have been sorted out, but they were confident that enough of them are sorted out that we'll make this work going forward, and the city's definitely going to be a good part of filling the gap. Hi.
Hi. Is there a lower your option for people about homes right now?
So, you want to speak to that, Kevin, in terms of what's happening right now?
The question is,
is there a low barrier option right now, and what's happening to people right now until December 1st?
I mean, I think that, you know, it's common knowledge that there's a lot of people staying in motels right now, and so that's probably the best low barrier option. I mean, I think it's that's why we're doing this, is to make sure that there is like a year-round, ongoing, you know, sustainable low-barrier option. So, I don't know if that answers the question.
I just know
that it's
the campground, so
it's not really working. Yeah, I mean, I'll just say, we feel the weight of getting this open by December 1st, right? We fully feel the weight that, like, it's a gap. And, every year, we started running, the low-barrier facility last winter, got it up and running by November 1st. That's always the goal. Obviously, you know, you can see right now, it's like, you know, we bought it on Friday. The contractor showed up this morning, and so it looks like, I mean, you know, it's going to be up and running by December 1st, but that's a month later than we normally would do. So, it's, yeah, we want to get it as quickly as possible, for sure.
How will COVID guidelines play into spacing people out in bedrooms and, you know, I don't know if there's certain beds, number of beds to a room or something like that, or picking them out?
Yeah, so when we first came and checked out the facility, David McKay, he's one of our board members, right there, cool looking hat. We came up here with a measuring tape, right? And just, we really did to figure out, like, okay, we went old school on it, right? Just in, like, how far can you space the beds? Like, how many people can you get, you know? And so there's 33 units, maybe able to get there's 33 units, and we probably technically could have gotten more than 50, but we just felt like after measuring it all out, looking at our staffing structure, everything like that, the 50 is what we could handle here. There's some of the rooms are going to be private, some are going to be semi-private, because we do have people there in the same pod, and we can kind of double up in some of the rooms and still have 6 feet spacing there.
And will there be
a quarantining requirement? Is that what you said? Well, I mean, like this with every shelter, you know, with like a lot of facilities serving people experiencing homelessness, like we have to have like space for isolation, right? So if somebody's symptomatic. The great thing about this is people are already in their own room, right? Or semi-private rooms. That takes away kind of the guessing game on that. And I think it's also great that there's a COVID recovery site up on Wilson Road at the Ho-Hum Motel. If somebody's COVID positive, we already have a process in place for people to go there. And so, I mean, and they do a great job there of making sure people are negative before they return to the general population too. So, and I have to say, like, a lot of that, I know there's not other agencies here. Cathedral Square is another agency as part of that. I mean, part of the reason the COVID recovery site works is because of the Chittenden Homeless Alliance. We all play in the same sandbox really well. I mean, that's the reason things like that, like this, are happening, is I think there's a lot of support from our organizations to figure out how to work out these problems.
Question. For homeless people who use drugs or drink alcohol, will they be allowed here? And if so, will there be like supervision or medical staff here?
So this is low barrier, which means there's no sobriety requirements, right? So you know, that's what part of what it means. We always have 24/7. If there's clients or guests on site, we're on site, right? And so that will be here. We're not medical staff. We partner with community health centers in Burlington with their Safe Harbor Clinic. And so usually if there's something medically related, that's who comes on site to assist us.
So one of the goals always has been of this, the low barrier facilities, is that there would be services provided that if people, that basically, people staying in this facility, that it become that the operators do everything that they could to help those individuals get access to whatever services would help them get to a different place in life, whether that's permanent housing or a job or medically assisted treatment. That has always been a goal of these low barrier facilities going back to when we first created one in 2014. I would say it's a goal that we've had limited success with. There definitely have been some success stories, but one of the benefits that we're hopeful about there being a year-round facility, one that a facility that isn't opening and closing every 6 months, that has a great deal of staff turnover as a result of being a seasonal facility, is that the wraparound services provided to people staying in this facility should be far superior to what we've been able to provide in the past facilities. And I know that's a goal of new places, and it's something the city is really interested in, and we're doing everything we can to support as well.
Thank you.
One reason this works, I mean, CA's been recognizing her, but it's Heather Bush, our shelter coordinator. Before we brought her on staff a year ago, I used to refer to her as a social work ninja. She was worked for St. Harbor Health Clinic before coming on staff with us. And so I think that gives me a lot of confidence that when people come here, they're getting a new start and that we're going to connect them. You know, you can't force people to say yes to services, but this allows us to bring services to people, and it greatly enhances the chance they're going to say yes. And I think part of it is also just people are in a low barrier environment because a lot of times because there's a lack of relationships in their life, they don't have people they trust. It's one reason I ask these five people to be here is they're good at building trust, right? And that's the first step in people saying yes to services, right? And there's no quick fix to it. And so, we're really encouraged by just having a space where somebody can walk across the parking lot and meet with a case manager right there. And that's a game changer.
Thank you. Does this plan have any bearing on the city's kind of knowledge of the Sears Lane encampment? The original proposal was to put the mini housing units there and to bring services to that kind of existing area where folks congregate. I'm wondering, does this have any bearing on that? Does the city have any plans to address Sears Lane? Or are you hoping that those folks come here?
I think you understand this, Gordon, but just to be clear, like this is that effort that there was some reporting around, like this is the culmination of that effort, and the facility, this is the facility that's happening as opposed to that original concept of this sort of tiny home concept there. I would say in general, one of the reasons that this is a really important facility is because when the winter warming facility has closed, that has meant that a lot of people, you know, a significant number of people have headed out into the woods and into these sort of interstitial spaces around the city and set up these makeshift encampments. And that's one of the places we've seen that happen frequently down on Sears Lane. And one of the very positive elements of this facility is that, you know, a lot of people who are staying in encampments like that don't want to be there. They would much prefer to have a roof over their head. They would much prefer to be in some kind of low barrier facility, and one that serves them simply hasn't existed. And so, yeah, I absolutely think that this is a tool that we haven't had in the past for helping serve people find themselves at Sears Lane. Not everyone is going to want to avail themselves of this type of service, but many of the people we know from having, you know, talked directly with them and worked with many people in encampments over the years, that many of them would be more than happy to be here at the Champlain Inn if it had existed and it will exist going forward. So yes, I hope that's good. Mm-hmm. All right, I think we're, I'm happy to stick around if people do have more, but why don't we let folks go. Thank you all for coming out and being part of this important day.